other big stories as well, where the All India Muslim Personal Law Board has issued a statement on the sacking of senior advocate Rajeev Dhavan. And there is an apparent big divide that is happening within the Muslim sides itself, where the All India Muslim Personal Law Board has called for a change in the decision. This comes after Rajeev Dhavan was sacked by the Jamaat-e-Ulema-e-Hind, which has thereafter gone forward when it comes to filing their review petition. But the divide there now, looking up front, where you have Rajeev Dhavan says that he's been sacked from the case, but he will continue to be following up the case very soon. And all those things that were said when it comes to his illness or him being not well, that is completely rubbish that has been said by Rajeev Dhavan. He spoke to Republic TV. We'll be playing out the entire reaction. And at this point, this is coming at a time where Rajeev Dhavan had earlier in the day posted on social media where he said that he's been sacked from the Babri case as an advocate. And that has happened on record. Now, why is that? You see, the Muslim parties are maintaining distance or are now rather shying to give a public statement on the same, where you have Rajeev Dhavan saying that he has sent across a formal letter accepting the sacking without demur and no longer involved in the review of the case. How exactly is the All India Muslim Personal Law Board going to take up the matter? Because they are backing Rajeev Dhavan now. Now, one thing is to remember that Rajeev Dhavan was representing several Muslim parties when it comes to the Babri Masjid case. And you have one side who do not want him to represent their case. The other side, if you're talking about the All India Muslim Personal Law Board, they are backing Rajeev Dhavan. So this divide that is now coming to fore. And at this point, we'll play out the entire reaction from Rajeev Dhavan himself, where he had also rubbished all those claims that were being made that he is unwell and he is not fit to take over the case that he has been closely following up and keeping aside all those controversies as well. But he is the man when it comes to the Babri Masjid case who was arguing for those Muslim parties.
He got death threats in the Ayodhya case. He was the only voice speaking for the Muslim lawyers in the Ayodhya case in the top court. Now, word coming in that senior advocate, one of the country's constitutional legends, Rajeev Dhavan, has possibly, according to him, been sacked from being a part of the Muslim group. We speak to him to understand what actually happened. Mr. Dhavan, you were the one lawyer for all the Muslim groups appearing in whatever capacity, in every capacity, working day and night for this case. How is it that you are feeling you're sacked? When we speak to the other side, they say we want you. It was just a matter of technical legal settlement that could not happen on that very day.
To say I was possibly sacked is wholly and completely untrue.
You were sacked, you think?
I was sacked. The word is sacked. I have said this to other channels. I never want to speak to Republic TV because I have no faith in them. But seeing that you are an old friend, I had to oblige. Let me tell you what happened. For the last 10 days, I have been working on the review. On the review with Mr. Maqbool and his team. We had three meetings. In fact, the structure of what has been filed was, in fact, prepared by me and shared with the other Muslim parties. I left all of Sunday free to tweak that particular draft. I typed it myself over a period of 8 hours. I went to my dentist for a routine checkup. At 10:14, Mr. Maqbool called my clerk and said, Mr. Dhavan ko phone do. I told him that, yes, what's the matter? He said, I don't want you to be associated with this case and review. I said, could we call it a sacking? He said, yes, but I have no say in this matter. He said that I can't do anything.
Why? Why do you think this could have happened, Mr. Dhavan?
Let me complete the story. I came back. I sent a letter to him saying that you have sacked me and that we've had meetings together and that as a professional, I have no choice but to accept this without demur. The case and the cause is bigger than all of us. So when Mr. Maqbool says that it was because of some technical problem. In fact, there was no technical problem. The case could have been filed on Saturday, and I worked towards the case being filed on the very date Mr. Maqbool filed it. His juniors came to me. They saw my alternative draft. We worked on it only for the record because the case had already been filed. Unfortunately, if Mr. Maqbool says he didn't sack me, why did he not reply to my letter? And it is not just an untruth, it is actual total lies. The other lie in this case is that I was not well. Now, how could I have not been well if I had worked 10 days on this brief, I'd scheduled a meeting, I worked on it all day Sunday for the final draft? Why was I not well? I could argue the Karnataka case after Babri, several other cases, including cases on reservation. Now, why was I not well? I'm perfectly well. I've always been perfectly well. There are some problems of teeth pain, but then who doesn't have it?
Dr. Dhavan, I want to ask you, why do you think the step is taken? There are people in the All India Muslim Personal Law Board who are tweeting, we still want him to be our counsel. What was the fallout that could have led to this, if any?
See, this has happened before. Mr. Maqbool put pressure on me earlier because he said I should appear for the Jamiat because they want me to appear for them. Other parties said I need to appear for them and not for the Jamiat. I told Mr. Maqbool I will not enter into this controversy. It's simply a problem that they must sort out, but I will accept the Jamiat brief because I've been arguing it for a number of days. And it was the lead brief in the matter. It was as simple as that. Over this period, there was some friction amongst the Muslim parties, which is inevitable. There was also friction amongst the Hindu parties. Therefore, we kept the team together, and one part of my responsibility was to keep the team together.
Were you able to, or were there some fights that used to break out, Dr. Dhavan?
Oh, inevitable fights. Somebody wanted to come here from Mr. Shamshad's chamber because she wanted to get involved in the discussions here in this very room. Mr. Shamshad instructed his juniors not to come and attend these meetings. I said, it doesn't matter, we will go ahead. And that's what happened. But to say that I wasn't sacked and to say that I'm ill is an absurdity. And the third absurdity is to say that the time would have been breached. Because I was working towards filing on Monday. The last date is Saturday.
Dr. Dhavan, I want to ask you, the Shia Waqf Board and others who were part of the mediation, they also tried to solve this through a mediation process. Was that mediation process, according to you, successful? Because we remember there was so much controversy when a letter came out that the Shia Waqf Board is looking for a conclusion through the mediation process.
The stance of the Shia Waqf Board was nothing short of disgraceful. There was a case that was decided against them in 1946. Last year, they filed an SLP 70 years later, saying that this was actually theirs. I'd pointed out to them in court. In fact, I called one of their counsels, Traitoruddin. The reason was, the Shia Waqf Board said, we give this site. Can you give what you don't have? Can you file a case after 70 days? So the Shia Waqf Board is playing its own game. And frankly, I didn't want to get into that either. My task was to win for the Muslims, and it is well settled that from 1528 onwards, it was a Sunni Waqf. For the Shias to derail this is disgraceful.
Sunni Waqf Board, do you think there was some parallel talk that they were having within the mediation? Was there something that was brewing? Because that mediation is something they emphatically wanted to happen.
In August, before the 40-day hearing started, the position was that mediation had come to an end. Suddenly, the Sunni Waqf Board, somewhere towards the end, said that we want to mediate. The order of the court was that they can mediate with the mediators or by any other method. In other words, in my view, the mediation committee had become functus officio. This in law means that they had no more function to perform. Mm-hmm. On the penultimate day, Mr. Siriram Panchu wrote a letter, assuming that it was done on behalf of all three, and said he needs protection for the chairman of the Sunni Waqf Board, which was granted. Now, the question is, why did the Sunni Waqf Board chairman need protection? Not from the Muslims. I'm given to understand pressure was put by Chief Minister Adityanath on the Sunni Waqf Board chairman, and therefore he turned around completely. The so-called mediation can hardly be called that. The Shias were there. The Sunni Waqf Board chairman was there. Somebody was there from the Hindu Mahasabha, and two nondescript people. Can you imagine this to be a mediation? On the last day, Mr. Panchu sent another report. I'm assuming it was on behalf of the committee. And the mediation proposal I'm given to understand is that the Sunnis were prepared to give the land. We don't know what happened. I wrote about this interference. I consider it interference since they had become functus officio in a real sense by Shriram Panchu in both the Wire and the Caravan.